The prevailing agricultural systems are based on the notion that food must conform to specific appearance standards to be appealing. Consequently, this has led to the production of irradiated foods, allowing fruits and vegetables to maintain their appearances for extended periods on store shelves. Cultivating vegetables in a home garden represents a straightforward yet transformative remedy to numerous health, environmental, and economic challenges. At the Mukono Zonal Research and Development Institute, various crops are being studied, including research on vegetables and fruit backyard gardening. Today, we interview researchers from Mukono Zonal Research and Development Institute to understand why many people have been hesitant to embrace backyard gardening despite its numerous advantages. Immaculate Mugisa Ojara will provide a definition of urban farming and urban agriculture.
Urban agriculture refers to any kind of activity that involves, for instance, production, crop and animal production, or post-harvest handling, value addition, transportation and marketing, anything within that of agricultural produce, but within the confines of the urban and peri-urban areas. And urban farming specifically refers to crop or animal husbandry. You're taking care of animals or you're cultivating crops within the urban or peri-urban setting. So the population within urban areas is increasingly growing, not only in Uganda but worldwide. And with increasing urban populations comes an increased demand for food in urban areas. So it's important that food within urban areas is supplemented by the people who are actually living in urban areas.
Immaculate Mugisa guides us through the world of backyard gardening, illustrating how it can not only enhance your food security and nutrition, but also serve as a lucrative source of income.
There are a number of things that you could actually do. You could have what they call a cake garden, which is right here in front of us. You could set up a ridge in your backyard. You could set up a food tower. You can use any kind of different kind of structures. It's all about innovation, something that can be able to grow food for you, to grow some vegetables in your backyard. So apart from that, when you go to the aspect of agriculture, you can do rabbitry, you can do livestock, you can different kinds of livestock like chicken and the like. But for crops specifically, we are going to take you into a bit of it to show you, for instance, if you're setting up a cake garden, this is how it looks and this is how you should set it up.
Starting backyard gardening can be challenging for beginners. However, it does not have to be overwhelming. By breaking the project into manageable steps, you can gradually ease into gardening at your own pace. Immaculate provides a helpful guide on how to set up your backyard garden with ease.
Setting up a backyard garden is not something that is so expensive. There are different types of innovations that someone can take up, but they range from expensive to cheap. I'll give you examples. If you're constrained financially, you can set up something simple like a cake garden, like a food tower, like a ridge in your backyard. And these, you use simple materials that don't cost so much. For instance, for this cake garden right in front of us, all you need is that black polythene. You need the good quality soil and possibly some stones to help to improve on the drainage. And it is something similar with a food tower, because you'll just have to maybe add some poles and nets, this which is right behind me here. But for the youth who has more money available to them, you can try other options. You can go into what they call, I know they are going to tell you about the aquaponics, where you bring in the fish farming integrated with the vegetable farming. You can do hydroponics. You can choose to put a small greenhouse somewhere if you have a little bit more space. So the materials vary. If you really don't have the money, you can actually start with simple materials. To be able to have a neat ridge in your backyard, all you need is wood and some polythene, like you're going to see, that can be able to help you, you know, make it look a bit neat in your backyard, and you're good to go. And the seed, you can always access. Buy vegetable seeds, probably from Container Village or from some of these companies that sell the horticulture seed, and then raise it in a nursery. So it's not something that is so complicated. Yeah, for the farmer, for the backyard gardener who would like to cultivate crops in their backyard without using inorganic chemicals, we have organic options. At the moment, there are some organic pesticides on the market which will actually not harm you. Actually, we may not really advise you to go spraying some of these chemicals in your backyard. So you can be able to get in touch with us. We can be able to advise you on how to access those organic chemicals, organic pesticides, which are made from these natural materials. And in addition to that, some of you think possibly some of these plants will increase on the mosquitoes or the like that are in the compound. But you could also, within your compound, plant some of these plants that are kind of like insect repellents. We have things like the lemongrass. They are crops that actually, when you have them in your compound, they repel the Mexican marigold, those plants that have those yellow flowers. You can put a few in your compound that can help to repel some of these pests.
Robina Nagayi Gafabusa, a senior research technician at the Mukono Zono Agricultural Research Development Institute, is an enthusiastic urban farmer who advocates for and promotes urban farming. With great passion, she emphasizes the importance of proper garden planning for obtaining healthy crops and achieving favorable outcomes from even a small backyard farm.
However much it is small, we need to plan. As you see, these vegetables are supposed to be healthy. And when they are healthy, it's like you when you are feeding your kids. Those kids which are not fed well, they will succumb to different diseases and pests. So you have to prevent them from getting affected than chewing them. Because when it comes to chewing, that's when you will bring even those synthetic chemicals. But as I told you right from the beginning, you have to plan. Like, should I say we start with the soil which we are going to use? And we usually call it media because it is composed of three material. I would have said that someone to start would have looked for the black soil, because generally we know that black soil have nutrients. Then secondly, you would have looked for manure. I feel and I stress this, that whoever grow vegetables around home, they should be with manure. Either you go and look for manure which has decomposed, or you decompose yours at using the whatever you have around you. So when that one has decomposed, you can use it as manure. And thirdly, that being that these plants are planted in a place which is restricted, you have to allow drainage during watering. So in that media, you have to mix, we call it olusenyente, charcoal dust. As I told you, we plan. When we are mixing those three, it has to be in a ratio of 3:1:1. Let us assume that you are using a wheelbarrow. If you are using a wheelbarrow, bring three parts of wheelbarrow, put one part of manure, and one part of charcoal dust in the soil, and you mix it thoroughly. After mixing it, then you fill the gardens which you are seeing here. Unless you are just making a raised bed, there it doesn't matter. You just feed manure because there is enough soil and enough space. But if you use gardens like a tire, like those sacks, like this food tower, like the cake, you have to mix the three, such as there is enough nutrients for the plant, and at the same time, that water has to drain away. What I have not told you, when you are planning for this, for urban farming, you have to look for the quality of a seed or a seedling. Because remember that you are going to plant very few. You have to maximize the profit. So when it is a tomato, don't just go around and just uproot whatever tomato you see. Go for a tomato which is you feel that it can yield well. There are some tomatoes which even climb. We call them indeterminate what? Tomatoes. As you pluck out, others are coming. Those crops are the best. Even when you go for eggplants, I mean a plant which you can't just plant and you harvest once at a go. It would have been better that you look with for a seedling which will keep on producing, which is semi-perennial, I should say, like entula, like eggplants, like tomatoes. But we also know that from the basis of our science, we need nutrients. There are some vegetables which have been growing all the time and they mature in 1 month. You can even go for that, like a nakati, buga, and a jovio. But even you have crops like sukuma wiki, those are the leafy vegetables which are exotic, like spinach, such that when you pluck some leaves below, others will keep on growing. So go in for those. And that's why you see that when you look in our garden, we have a lot of spring onions. You know how spring onions are so nice in our luombo, in boiled meat. And when we are harvesting them, you just take one, then others come in a cluster. So go in for the quality of a seedling, which will keep on yielding time after time.
Nagai provides essential guidance on how to initiate a successful backyard garden, including necessary steps and key components for maximizing your garden's yield.
When we need labor, like such a structure, I have to call boys and they do something like that. I can't climb up to that level. It depends which structure you are doing. But even that one which is down like the other food tower, it requires someone with energy because you have to mix the other three and then nail those poles and then put there the wire mesh, which requires someone like a man. So you have to invest in for that little labor. But other material, I should say they are more available at home. And even it helps us to clean our place. When you see that bugs are thrown somewhere, I think you have seen how I feed them with the other media, and I plant onions. And anybody at home can take that responsibility of looking every after a garden. Usually when you are starting urban farming, you have to think of that cost benefit. What am I putting on and what I'm putting? If you happen to get someone who is too much what? it is costing you. But I would say, for example, you can come here once and you get that briefing. Like when we are starting this, you have to make sure that you follow all the agronomical practices. Should I say agricultural practices? It's like when you get a baby when you are in a hospital and they tell you that at this level you have to feed like this. At this level you have to immunize this. That's what is supposed to be happening on our crops. So right from planting, as I told you, if it is a bed, as you see, to every hole, put there a handful of manure and you make a background of it. After that, if it is a tomato like this one, it is supposed to be staked. When you leave it on the ground, yes, it will fruit, but during weeding, you will just keep on stepping on them. And I think when you are looking at this bed, you see that here, the length, the width, it is short, such that at my working on it, I don't step inside. But when you make it so wide, it will mean that whoever is having, you will make many lines, and the time will come when you will step in. And the moment you step in that soil, you are interfering with the root movement. So the agronomical practices are supposed to be. What I mean with other agronomical, you have to maintain the plant spacing. Here you are seeing that this is my tomato. In a garden I can space it at 60 by 60 centimeter. But when it comes here I reduced it to 45 centimeter, such that I will manage it well and I will maximize, I will plant more plants in that small plot of land. But when you reduce on the spacing, it means that you will get more plants in an area. But if you have more plants and you don't maintain them, how do I mean by maintaining? It is staking them, mulching the soil, watering at that moisture content when you don't give it too much water. And you have to keep on seeing that every time my soil is moisture. Because this land is very small, you have to put a lot of emphasis on it. You monitor it every day, every evening, every word. You have to control pests and diseases.
Collaboratively, organizing the gardens and compounds for our homes is crucial, which is why receiving proper training before commencing our backyard gardens is essential. Nagayi guides us through various styles that we can adopt to create beautiful compounds and backyard gardens.
This is called a fudu tower, and we have a wide and a long. And this, the advantage of the long one, it accommodates many plants. Here I have 30 spinach and I have onions there. But if you want, you can integrate or you plant in more onions, like those spring onions. And you see that I'm planting alongside on the sides. Then even I have some. Here we have spinach, and here we have kale. It's also very good. A vegetable which is continuous. But to its cost, you see that I have 9 poles. And I have to be with other poles like 4 down, which are of the same height. And these poles, they are 1 meter. And 1 foot, almost 4. 1 meter, it is almost like a 3 point something feet. So you make it 4, and 1 foot goes down, then you remain with almost a meter up. Another expense, it is on this wire mesh, where I said that you have possibly to involve labor. But before you fix it, you first fix the inside one, the four, and then you pour a basin of stones. Then after putting stones inside, then you fix these 9 poles very firmly. And then you buy your wire mesh. I usually buy wire mesh of 50,000, and I can make 5 out of them because it is long. They don't sell piece. So when you fix them, you fix it on the poles, then you pour the other mixture which I told you, and it fills it. After filling, then you start planting. The importance of this stone, if you don't put stone inside here, during drought it is so, let us say, a very big problem. When you keep on watering from here, there is runoff, which would have said soil erosion. So what you, being that you will know that this something, it is in our home, at times we expect a tap from there. You just buy a hose pipe, bring it, place here. And you remember in our science that when you put water here, it will run from that high concentration position to low, or in a process called what? I think you remember. So water will move from here. As it is going down, it is taking direction to this low concentrated part, meaning that the plants will just tap water as it is moving. But when you keep on watering from here, first of all, you can there is a chance of getting erosion. Secondly, there is a chance of getting a hard pan inside. And when you create a hard pan inside, you will use it for one season. So avoiding all that, you put stones and water from inside, and the water just moves by itself. As I told you that we are maximizing our land, we just consider the bottom part of it. Because the circumference, when I was measuring, that's why I said that you have to plan the whole of this cavera. It was like 4 meters to 5. And you cut it in pieces. So the first piece down, which will hold the lower bottom, it was 15 feet. When we closed it, it became to 7.5 what in diameter. So we are using an area of 7.5. Then when you begin by 15, you keep on cutting 3, 3, 3. I began with 15, then I went to 12, then 9, and then this is the 15. Such that the diameter, it is 7.5. So you are using an area down which is 7.5. Then the second level, it is this one. I cut 3 feet and I remained with the 12. So if it is 12, the diameter here is 6. Then you go to this level, you cut another 3, or you reduce to 3. Then you remain with what? With 9, until you go. So it depends on how many levels you need. But maximum, I don't think that you would have gone beyond 6 layers or 6 level. Because if they are beyond that, it will be very hard for you to water. You will be straining yourself. In urban farming, you have to do things which are in your own means. So the expense we incur here, it is buying this chivera. And you know, a meter, it is just 3,000. And here, I bought only 5 meters. That is 15,000. The labor, when I'm closing them, I use a needle and a thread. And you make these different layers. And you fill the other media, which I talked about. But here, when you look at this cake, you see that we also went extra mile of getting a good quality of a seedling. And I've planted 10 tomatoes of them. This variety, it is called MV. It can put like 100, on average, it is around 100 to 150 tomatoes. And they don't harvest all at once. But if we analyze the situation where we are in now, one tomato is what? 200. It is between 200 and 5. It's rare to get a tomato of 100 these days. Let us assume that we are selling it at 200. And they are 10. And out of that 10, each one is producing something like 100 to 100. How much money are you getting from here? And remember that I have even leafy vegetables on them, such that every week I can harvest a handful for my family. But even onions are there. They are repairing, and at the same time, I will get leaves out of them. That's why we are saying that we are trying to maximize whatever small land, piece of land you have.
Farming in urban settings can pose heightened difficulties due to factors like constrained space, insufficient soil, and pollution exposure. Moreover, urban agriculture often incurs elevated expenses attributable to the pricey land and resource demands. Nevertheless, despite these obstacles, urban farming holds the promise of playing a substantial role in enhancing food security and sustainability within global urban zones. Given the increasing urban population, the prominence and significance of urban farming are anticipated to escalate. Nagai briefly outlines a preview of the challenges associated with urban farming that one should anticipate prior to embarking on such an endeavor.
The challenge is running away, and you say that I'll keep on spraying. There you will be suffocating your home with chemicals. Then another challenge is how you handle the waste. However much you see all these bags, all these sacks, after harvesting, or after getting old, I should say, and you don't collect them in one area, they will become a havoc to your what? To your compound. So much as you are working on them, make sure that even you collect the buveras of those pots where you have bought seedling from.
Cultivating produce within your urban garden is experiencing a surge in popularity. A growing number of individuals are recognizing their yearning to personally nature a portion of their dietary provisions. This inclination is effortlessly accessible for experimentation, as intricate tools are unnecessary and gardening can occur on a balcony or terrace, making use of any available space. This concludes the Harvest Money Show for now. Until next week, goodbye and take care.
Mm-hmm.